I'm Sandra Oldfield. I'm a founder of Tinhorn Creek Winery and partner of Elysian Projects now.
So what is next now for Elysian then?
Well, I mean, I'm playing that difficult role right now of trying to figure out, should I step back and kind of see what's going on in the industry and what role I can play? And then the tension with it is I'm also kind of a workaholic.
Yes.
And so do I jump in and just start taking consulting projects? So I'm trying to find a balance between those two things. I am looking more at how do I raise the boat of all the wineries in the industry instead of just working with one winery.
Is it going to be impossible for you to retire?
Well, there's no R word for me. Like, I am not retired. Retirement was thrust upon me. The sale was not necessarily something that my husband and I chose. And so for me, I do kind of see, you know, I've got another 20 years where I have a large amount of knowledge of this industry, a passion for it, obviously. I really want to make that work for the people that are still in it.
Yes.
And give them some tools to up their game and hopefully to find a little bit of more cohesion for the wineries out here.
So our April issue is our next big thing issue.
Yep.
What do you think will be the next big thing in across British Columbia?
We're going into a part right now with a harder to find grapes, so that means that wineries will sell out a little bit faster than they may have, you know, inventories have mostly gone away. And so that tends to mean that wineries start honing in on the markets that suit them best. What I'm hoping though is we get a positive decision with the direct-to-consumer Como case in the next month or two. And that might help focus some wineries on expanding across Canada more than what they're currently doing. It's being able to capitalize on the relationship typically of a consumer, like someone from Alberta who's come out to the winery. They've formed a relationship with that winery. They want it to extend into the rest of the year for them. It's such a teeny, teeny amount of the whole amount of wine that's drunk in Canada, but it's such a huge impact on this small industry. So, you know, I don't think it threatens anything out there. And what I think it does is, again, it's not like there's a finite amount of wine that Canadians can drink. I think it makes the pie larger. And it actually starts incorporating what I've been hoping would happen for a while, which is how does Canada start finding a Canadian wine culture? And they can't do it if they don't have access to the wines. End of sentence, right? So if you got more access to Australian wines, how do you build a Canadian wine culture? And by culture, I mean, you know, how does that BC wine go with that Nova Scotia lobster that you're having today? Or how does that Nova Scotia wine go with, spot prawns out in BC? I mean, those kinds of things have just never occurred yet.
If you had to, you know, tell a young winemaker who's starting out a word of wisdom, what do you think it would be?
It would be something they typically don't learn till they're in like their 20th or 30th year of winemaking, so they wouldn't listen to me anyway. You guide the wines that you are given from the vineyard, given that vintage. So stop trying to push wines in a certain direction and take what you've gotten and make the best thing from what Mother Nature gave you that year. And young winemakers tend to want to put their stamp on wines. And as they get older, they realize that it's futile, really. The grape comes back to what it wants to be. If you had just let it express itself from the get-go, you would have a lot less work and you'd be a little bit more relaxed. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.